Yeah, so my presentation is also about building blocks, but a different kind of building blocks. And basically, I will have a presentation about flexible groins. We are doing a lot with innovation. We have climate change. We have to adapt. And therefore, we are looking into innovations which can help us to manage with climate change. This is a nice graph of a flexible groin in the IJssel River. It was constructed exactly 2 years ago, and it is still there, and it's part of a pilot project. So we're doing a pilot project with partners to see whether we can manage the rivers in a different way when adapting to climate change. Now, why do we need river groins? The Netherlands is full of river groins, and we have several hundreds of river groins. And basically, they help us to maintain the river at a certain depth for inland navigation. So we center the flow in the river, and the river flow will erode the bed, and therefore we have a navigable depth. It also prevents the banks from erosion. So in the past, the Netherlands, we are busy with the rivers already for hundreds of years. So we have shortened the rivers, and therefore, we have cut off the curves of the river, and we want to maintain it like this now. There are many issues with the groins. Basically, the groins are perpendicular to the river flow, and we have more extreme river flow because of climate change, and the groins increase the height, they increase the flood heights. And therefore, they are affecting our water safety. What we also have is that we like inland river transport because it takes the trucks off our roads, but we transport with bigger and bigger ships, and those bigger ships have bigger engines, make bigger waves, and cause bigger erosion, and they also cause damage to the existing groins. The existing groins have another issue, is that they concentrate the flow very well, and they are fully impermeable structures, and we have big scour holes at the heads of these groins. The sand from these scour holes ends up in the navigable part of the river, and therefore they hinder the traffic in the river. Because we have shortened the rivers, the riverbeds are lowering, and that gives an issue because the existing groins have not been designed for that. So they are getting higher compared to the riverbed, and that's also an issue. The existing groins have been built as fixed structures with a lot of transitions, a lot of different materials, and they suffer quite a lot from damage due to the increasing hydraulic loads, both from climate change and from shipping. Therefore, there's a lot of maintenance required. Now, how does a traditional groin look like? This is in 3D sketch on the left side and some cross sections. And typically, we have a lot of different materials. So we build up a core, and then we a core of sand, and then we have rock layers. We have pitched rock layers. We have pitched concrete blocks. We have gravel. We have geotextiles. We have hardwood. So a lot of different materials and a lot of transitions. Now, these are fixed structures, so we have groins which are over 100 years old. Fixed structures, they have been there for forever, but they are very difficult to maintain. If you have somewhere damage, it's difficult to maintain, but they are also difficult to adapt. Because of climate change, we have these bigger discharges, so we are already lowering hundreds of groins because we want to reduce the resistance of these groins when we have large discharges. And that's difficult because of all these transitions. What you can also see is that they are quite gentle structures, so they have a large footprint, so typically they have 1 in 3 slopes, and therefore they also need large volumes of materials to be built. And finally, they are impermeable, so hard structures, closed, impermeable. Now, we have come up with an innovation. An innovation we think will help us managing the rivers in times of climate change. And basically what we do is we make the groin only of one material. We do not have hardwood, we do not have rock, we do not have sand, we do not have geotextiles, no transitions. And we make them from an X-shaped block. And this X-shaped block is just gravel, sand, and the binder material. And that's all. And we place these blocks in bulk, and then we can also build groins. These blocks, they are special shape. This shape has already been used in the Netherlands in Katzand. The weakling Katzand has two breakwaters to protect the pumping station. And there we call them X blocks. They are quite big, 4 cubic meter size, 2 meters high. But in the river we can use the same shape, but then only 33 centimeters high. Because of this special shape, we can build them in very steep slopes. So instead of 1-in-3 slopes, we go to 1-in-1 slope, and therefore we reduce a lot of material. And also an advantage is that they have a lot of voids. So of the groin itself, only 40% of the volume is these blocks, and 60% is voids. So 60% is empty, so is hollow space. Therefore, yeah, we have a porosity of 60%. That also means that they are, yeah, we have a more gentle transition of the flow around the head of the groin. With the traditional groin, this closed structure here, we have a porous structure, and part of the flow can still go through the structure. We place them directly on the riverbed. So no mattresses. We allow scour to happen, and we allow the structure to adapt to the scour holes. It's really a flexible structure. Now for this, we came up with this idea, we presented it to Rijkswaterstaat, and Rijkswaterstaat liked it idea, and yeah, of course, if you want to innovate, you need a pilot location, you really need to try it. There's some things you can do in a laboratory, but these kind of structures, you need a pilot location and try it in the real world. So Rijkswaterstaat proposed the IJssel River, and we built 3 groins in the IJssel River, and we did that with a few partners. We have Meteor, who's located along the IJssel River. They produce the extreme blocks. Van de Heerik built these groins. And Deltares does the research. And the pilot is now lasting already for 2 years, and we will continue for another 2 years. It's part of the maintenance contract for the IJssel River. The objective of Rijkswaterstaat is also to reduce the maintenance cost. The river still have quite high maintenance costs. And therefore, yeah, there's objective. How can we reduce the maintenance cost? Now, the advantages, we come up with a different solution. 100 years, the groins haven't changed in any shape. Always the same design was applied. Now, what is the difference? Now, the first difference is that it will adapt to changing riverbed levels. And we do not fix the riverbed levels. We allow the groin to partly sink into the scour hole and adapt to the riverbed levels. The groin is only made of one material, so it's flexible. And flexible means that we can adapt it easily. At a lot of locations, we want to steer the sediment. The sediment is moving, and often the groins do not do exactly what we want. And then you want to adapt it. If you make a groin of only one material, it's much more easy to adapt. You can lower it, you can shorten it, you can lengthen it, very easy. And yeah, we also want to adapt because of climate change. We are adapting existing groins, hundreds of them, because of climate change. And that's difficult because we have all these transitions with the hardwood, the geotextile, and so on. Now, the groin structure is permeable, so the flow transition is more gradually. But it also means that because we have 60% voids in these groins, that there is space to absorb wave energy. The big wave ships cause big waves, they cause shoreline erosion, and we want to absorb the wave energy. And finally, also because the groin is porous, it's also habitat for marine life. You have fish and other life in the river which can find shelter in the groin. Now, no transition means less maintenance. But also very important, with the steep slopes, we reduce the volume and therefore we reduce the cost, but also the CO2 footprint. Now, how do you build these groins? In bulk. So in the traditional groin, you build first you build a sand core, you profile it, you measure it, next layer, measure it, profile it, and layer. We don't do that. We only have an outer profile of the groin, and we fill it just with these extreme blocks. They are transported just in a river ship, with a big crane, and they are placed in bulk, and we can place 20 blocks at a time. The blocks weigh about 27 kilograms. Now, we can place them in the steep slopes. And so also construction is fast. And when you have fast construction, you also reduce the CO2 footprint. Now, the blocks have been cast along the IJssel River in the factory at Meteor. That's still in concrete, wet cast concrete. In the future, we will go to dry cast concrete. It's concrete or different binders. What we want to do is we want to use reused concrete. For instance, if we demolish such a building, we have a lot of concrete waste. We can crush that, we can reuse it, and we can also have very low CO2 footprint binders to make new blocks. Now for this pilot, in total 14,000 blocks have been produced. Now the research said, so if you do a pilot, yeah, there are a lot of performance indicators which we want to monitor. We monitor the riverbed levels. Deltares is doing this research. We look into the scour hole development. We look into the stability of the groins. We look into the permeability of the groins. And basically, yeah, the groins now function quite well for the past 2 years. And yeah, we have had three floods. And remarkably, of course, last July, we had a once in a few hundred year flood on the Maas River, but it also gave quite high discharge on the IJssel River. So even now in summer, we get extreme river discharges. Now, the research is ongoing. We also work together with students, also from Delft University. We do physical model tests. We do numerical modeling. We do physical model tests for scour holes. Yeah, a lot of items to be researched. Now, CO2 footprint is, of course, important. We want to, yeah, we have climate change, so climate change we have because of the CO2 emissions, so we want to have as low as possible CO2 emissions. We have made already a comparison on the, in Dutch, the Milieukosten indicator and the environmental cost indicator in English. And what we can conclude from that the CO2 footprint is about half of that of an existing groin. We are still continuing with life cycle analysis because we also want to take into account the speed of construction you have when you have a far more simple structure. When we will build anything, we always want to make it also good for nature. So the hard impermeable structures, they're closed surface, nothing can grow on that. And we would like to integrate structures with nature. And what you can see is that nature is already taking over the three groins which have been built in the IJssel. So we have a lot of driftwood that is already covering the groin, and yeah, plants are starting to grow in the voids of the groin themselves. So to conclude, yeah, flexible groins is an innovation. We think it's a suitable innovation to apply in rivers. You can manage the rivers with this type of structure. You can steer the sediments. You can adapt it in future if the climate change is going faster or slower than expected. It's resilient because no interfaces, so it's really a robust structure. We expect that it will reduce the local scour holes because it's permeable, so with less hard transition. It's we can have quite fast construction. We have already showed it for the pilot. The coming 2 years, what we will do is we will lengthen the groin in the outer bend of the river, and then we can again show the ease of construction. But there also we will use far more innovative binders, so we will have very low CO2 footprint binders. So we will also do a pilot on new types of binders just to make it the lowest CO2 footprint possible. That finalizes my presentation. Thank you
very much. Thank you very much, Bas. Are there any questions? Yes.
Thank you very much, Bas, for this inspiring presentation. It was really nice to see this this solution. I was wondering, because it's the former solution was a bit more like solid and rigid, maybe. And I was just wondering, like, how do you test if there's, for example, a very high discharge event with high flow speeds? How do you test if it holds, if it is strong enough and not, like, let's say, washed away by the water? How do you test that, and are you sure it's strong enough compared to the former solution?
Yeah, so we did physical model tests for that. So at Delft University, we did tests in a flow flume where we had basically the water flowing over the structure. And also around the head of a groin we did test. So we did determine that with these blocks you can easily have about 3 meters per second flow velocity without blocks being displaced. And we did in our own lab, we did test also for wave action. So we tested for ship-induced waves so that the blocks were stable.
Yes. Two questions. Thanks. I was wondering what because it sounds like a great solution, but I was wondering what the problem is looking like now, because are we thinking about replacing the current groins, and on what term, like what time scale are we talking about? Could you tell a bit more about this?
Yeah, so innovations take quite some time. So the idea already was formed 7 years ago, and 2 years ago we were able to start the pilot because we needed permits and a lot of parties involved, and a lot of effort. Basically, this location where we do the pilot, one groin was missing in the outer bend, and also on the inside was erosion of the shoreline. Therefore, this was a nice location to try. Many other groins in the Netherlands, they are not functioning correctly or are too high, so that also gives possibility to apply the system in the future. But we are also looking, for instance, at longitudinal dams. So in the Netherlands, because of the obstruction to river flow of the groins, there are a lot of locations where you want to replace the groins by a longitudinal dam. Now, this system could also be used for that.
Thank you for an amazing presentation and a flexible approach. My question is, from an environmental perspective, it is still dry and wet concrete, and it is directly going on the riverbed. Is there a potential, or have you already done an environmental impact study, and could you share some insights? Thank you.
Yeah, so to get the permit, of course, we had to show that there was no negative impact. So we had to prove that the concrete we used had no negative effect on the environment. But of course, yeah, we also for the next phase want to study the positive effects and study what life is in the groin itself. So we are continuing with the study to see all the effects.
Okay, well. Another last question.
Well, that's a very simple one. Because you can already see that the wood is the water levels have been higher. So how did it perform in these high flood circumstances?
Yeah. So basically, the groins are still there. The length is still as built, but what you can see that the scour holes have been developed near the groin, especially on the inner bend. There was a groin which is located near a clay ridge, and there a scour hole developed. And you see that the head has adapted. So you see that a few blocks have gone down into the scour, but in general they have functioned well in these floods.
Okay, Bas, thank you very much. Inspiring presentation, and I would say just apply, because there seems to be no disadvantages.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.